Three points. First of all, absolutely agree with John's comment. The design of packaging is about fitness for purpose. Things like end of life, etc., are important considerations. But if you know, there is nothing more useless than packaging that doesn't work. So you know, that's point one. I think the whole issue of infrastructure, etc., is very interesting because I think we're going through a fairly massive cultural change, and this is where local authorities and waste management companies sit in the middle of this, because we're moving away from an era where local authorities saw their main role as getting rid of the stuff at the lowest cost possible to the start of a value equation. And that's quite difficult for local authorities because they've been doing it on a no-risk basis. Value hasn't come into it, for most of them at least. And so there are some big changes. And there's one particular challenge, and that is the whole issue of waste management contracts with local authorities and who actually gets the value and so on. Because I think there's an awful lot of money. We frequently get the comment from local authorities, we need to see more money from the PRN system. Many of you will be familiar with the PRN system. The fact is, the amount of money in the PRN system is minuscule by comparison with the amount of value that's been hoovered up by the waste management company contracts with local authorities over the years. And the third point I wanted to make was about, you mentioned polymers. I have frequent and rather frustrating conversations with DEFRA and local authorities and others when I have to point out that moving from using 20 or 30 different versions of polymers to two or three is entirely possible if you want to do a lot less things, package a lot less products, etc. The plethora of polymers are used for a purpose, and that is because of their functionality, etc.
Sorry, I just remembered my second point. That's how bad my brain is. A brief point on responsibility as well. It's part of the Saver Cup story. An interesting point with Saver Cup was that it was set up by the industry and funded by the industry. So when Saver Cup first started, the people that were putting waste into bins didn't pay for it. The people that were creating the packaging paid for it. And over 20 years, that responsibility for the income that the business was driving, the cost, paying for the cost of the business, shifted from the industry through to the people putting the waste in the bins, and that's where it is today. We're 100% paid for by people putting waste in bins. In truth, where does the responsibility for recycling lie, for the development of the recycling value chain and actually paying for it? I think it lies with everybody, and something that we're trying to sort of focus back down on here is, yes, the consumer needs to be driven to recycle, the industry needs to be driven to recycle, the people all the way through that chain need to be driven to recycle, and it comes from government as well. So it's not just a single group. But what we see at the moment is kind of a blame shift. Mm. You know, nobody wants to pay for it, but they want it to occur. And we haven't got that right yet.
Okay. I mean, just a comment before we continue. I think it's interesting that we're talking about this in the weeks immediately following the publication of the proposed targets for recycling. And just to remind you what they are, steel, there's a proposal that between 2012 and 2017 we go up 1% a year to reach 76% in 2017. Aluminium is a proposal to go up 3% a year from 40% in 2012 to 55% in 2017. Plastics, and this is the big one, is a proposal to go up 5% a year from 32% in 2012 to 57% in 2017. I would be interested to have a show of hands as to who thinks that is achievable or not. So if we could say,
well, put that everybody achievable or not.
Is it? It's all right. No, I'm going to split the choices. So if we could say, do you think that is achievable? Hands up now.
It's a landslide.
Okay, it is a landslide. Comments.
Well, first of all, let's be clear that there are three sets of options for the targets.
Yes.
The government's preferred option is option three, which is the ones that you've set there. I can tell you from the conversations that I've had that, by and large, the targets, well, the target for paperboard was unchanged, and that was sensible because we're already up in the 80s anyway. The targets for steel and metal are mostly about recycling on the go, not entirely, because the metal targets, particularly steel and food cans, I mean, I wonder how many people in this room will feel slightly guilty, as I do, about not always religiously recycling our food cans as well as we do our drinks cans, etc. There's always a tendency just to sort of chuck the can of evaporated milk, shows how old I am, into the bin rather than into the recycling, whereas you wouldn't think, you wouldn't even dream of doing that with a drinks container. But nevertheless, there is a challenge there. But those targets for aluminium, for steel, have broadly been agreed with the industry in terms of discussions. The plastics target absolutely has not. DEFRA have completely ignored the conversations that have been taking place between DEFRA and the industry about what is achievable and feasible. Now, that's one of the reasons I asked the question of John Taylor about, and he said it will be a proper consultation, because if you think about it, first of all, it would put the plastics recycling rate in this country to the highest, effectively the highest in Europe. The reason I say that, it's not the highest in Europe, but the highest in Europe isn't all recycling. In Germany, for instance, a third of the recycling is plastics going into blast furnaces as a reducing agent, but it's counted as recycling. So if they insisted that it was 5% mechanical recycling, genuine recycling, if you like, that would put us by a long way the highest in Europe. You're not going to get the top level of performance with a third quartile infrastructure.
Richard, this is close to your heart, I think, so.
Yes, I mean, I think it's, and Josh, I think it's probably quite difficult for me to add much to what Dick has just said. I mean, this is open consultation. Lord Taylor has already said that, that this is opinions. I mean, I think it's worthwhile saying that the carbon benefits, particularly in the metals, the carbon benefits of all of them are significant. And I think, I think there's no doubt that we're all feel that we're on the journey towards capturing these resources and making the best use of it. And to take us back to the sort of hospitality voluntary agreement that we're thinking about at the moment, that's why recycling is in there, because capturing these are going to bring environmental benefits. And I think it's a journey worth taking. And there's a lot of value in those plastics.
I don't have anything to add to that, but one thing I would say is somebody once said if you set weak targets, then you don't achieve anything.
Yeah. And you're absolutely right, and I think I said that when I was doing the presentation as well.
It was you I was referring to.
Oh, right.